more entitled the idea of stop constructing walls. And as we said in the first section, we have three different concepts we're talking about. You know, the first one is the baggage that we bring into America. And we all bring in baggage, by the way, whether you're on your first marriage and you're just teenagers and you don't understand much about life. Of course, teenagers don't know they don't understand much about life, but and we all, you know, when we're teenagers, thought we knew it all. Didn't understand why people with no hair or lots of gray hair just, you know, telling us all these goofy things. we learned things. And we talked to a lot of people who come to us, and we start telling them things, and they say, well, we wish we had known that before we got married or pre-marriage and that sort of thing. And Carl and I were just talking about that several of the congregations up here have premarital coaching or counseling, and that's super. I hope that you have that in your congregation. If you don't, give me a shout, give you a business card, send me an email, and I'll give you six sets of questions that you can ask. And they're very open-ended, they're very easy, and you just kind of listen to the answers to people and try to reflect back to them where they are and where you're trying to help them. But premarital coaching or counseling, whatever you want to call it, is really important. I think it's interesting that couples spend hundreds and hundreds and sometimes thousands of dollars on a wedding day and nothing on their marriage. And so that's another hobby horse of mine. We'll get off of that one. We're going to talk about how to unpack this baggage and how to stop building these walls. And I mentioned to you, we are going to go through a couple of sets of verses in this section, the second section here. And part of it is you need to stop doing activities that force a division between you two. And sometimes we don't even think about that we are causing problems for our husband or our wife. We don't even realize that we are pushing them away. I talked to you in the first section about how that in Elaine and I's situation, I was the follower. And I don't mean that was a euphemism for, you know, raising. I mean, I breathed my voice. Now, you know, when I was at church, at the resident, of course, I was peaceful. But at home, I mistreated my wife terribly. And we took a seminar in her hometown, her home congregation, in 2015. And our sister-in-law, her brother's wife, came up and said, you know, I am so glad you changed. And I went, what do you mean, Linda? She says, you were terrible to Elaine. We lived in that town for the first year of our marriage. I didn't know anybody knew us like that. Oh yeah, people know what goes on. They may not know all the particulars, but they know what goes on. And they know when you're doing activities that force a division. And if you have kids around, they may not understand all that's going on, but they know something's going on. You know, they understand there's a problem there. Even if they don't understand what the problem is with mommy and daddy and the things that are going on there. So you brought all kinds of baggage in, and sometimes this is it. Well, I'm right. Well, I am too. Well, now what do you do? What do you do with that? I'm right. You know, in marriage, we have a book that we call the Bible, and we can go to the Bible and we can get lots and lots and lots of great information. But it's not a rule book. And I don't know where people came up with the idea that we need a rule book for marriage, or we need a rule book for bringing up kids. Bringing up kids has their rule book too. You know? And each one of them is different, as you well know. And each marriage is different. And so when we're working with couples, we have general question and answers, and we have general things that we're working with couples. But that's why we have a lot of fill in the blanks or open-ended questions. And I'll give you a real quick question for you. Maybe one for husbands and one for wives. Okay, and this is really easy. Just at your date time. You do date it, right? You date it. Yeah, okay. During your date time, just look at it and say, okay, honey, or whatever your preferred term is, not boss. Honey, What are three ways? Now think about that. Couldn't you answer this question really easy? What are three ways I can show you that I love you this week? If he asked you that question, would you give him some answers? Absolutely. One for you. But by the way, this is free. You don't have to pay anything. This for you. What she does is she looks at you and she says, honey, that good word works both ways, by the way. Honey, what are three ways that I can show you I either appreciate you, admire you, or respect you? One of those three. Or even, how can I show you that I value you as my husband? Any one of those four words. And they all mean the same thing. Because a lot of times we use the word respect, and men and women don't understand, well, what does respect look like in work boots? Well, it looks like confidence. Boy, I tell you what, my wife calls me her hero all the time. True story. That's I'm a hero. Yeah. I know what that means. You know, I kill mice. I reach things from the top shelf. I'm a hero. Come on. Also, when she says, you know, I'm so glad that I married you, and I'm glad you married me. You know, God has a sense of humor. My last name is Stumpf. Did you see my height? Okay. So I always used to say, my brother, by the way, in the fifth grade, was almost 6 foot tall in the fifth grade. And I used to be so mad. You know, why can't I be bigger? And when he tells me all the time, you're just the right size. Just the right size for you. All right. See, brother? You couldn't marry my wife. He's just right? All right. You brought all sorts of baggage into your marriage. I don't know what the baggage looks like. I don't know what, I was trying to figure out some ways to kind of give you some ideas as you're in each section. And I want you to think about, what kind of baggage did I bring into this marriage? And so I want to ask you this question. Which one are you building? Are you building walls? Are you building bridges? It's easier, by the way, to build walls. It's real easy to build walls. You know, we have preconceived ideas. We have all kinds of things in our backgrounds, and we build walls. What I want you to do is to think, how do I build bridges in my relationship? How do I open it up? I like that. I found that online there. True love isn't found. It's built. Oh, we just love each other. Well, that's good, but what does that mean? What does that look like? What does love really look like in work boots? You know, what does that mean? And ladies, please understand that Jesus had to tell his apostles directly, and if you look at the passage, John 13, he tells them three different ways. First, he says, I served you, or I did this for you, you washed your feet. The second thing he says, I'm going to give you a new commandment. That you love one another, verse 34. And then verse 35, he says, if you love one another, and I'm kind of rough paraphrasing a little bit, if you love one another, you'll draw all men to you for me, for my sake. Now think about that. Jesus never said that to a group of women. That's a group of men. You know why? Because those guys don't have love. We don't know what love is. You know? And you ladies love everything. Oh, honey, I love your hair. I love that necklace. Oh, that sweater. I just love that. And then you turn to your husband and you say, I love you. And your husband goes, I don't understand that. You know? Because true love is a fact. It's not something you catch. You know? And you actually didn't fall in love. That's a misnomer. You didn't fall in love. You know, there were interactions. There were times that you spent together. There were ways that you got to know one another. And love, if you didn't hear it at least three times in the last two sermons, you'll hear it some more. Love is a choice, not a feeling, when you're talking about agape. When you look at that passage of Scripture up there, and all in 1 John, and the way that John uses it in all five of his letters. The word love Love is not a feeling. It's not something you catch. Love is something that is built. It is not found. You don't discover it in that way. Let me give you seven. I gave you five before. I'm giving you seven suggestions to build a new relationship bridge. Again, you know, primarily we're talking to remarried circumstances, but I hope that, like in the first session, that you were able to learn some things through marriage, even if it's your first marriage. One brother and sister that sat over there said they've been married 65 years. And he said, thank you, I learned some things. Really? 65 years and you're still learning? Ought to tell us something. Ought to tell us something. So we can learn. We can learn. Number one, be fully committed to follow God. He is your ultimate source, your ultimate guide, no matter how difficult that may seem. You see, this is the way you need to, I'm sorry, I went too fast there. Somebody can take me notes, sorry. I started to do this and I get a handout and I didn't. If you want my slides, all you have to do is send me an email and say, send me my slides, I'll be glad to send them to you. They're not copyrighted or anything. I don't charge. This is the way that I hope that you focus your marriage. Just like this. Number one, God is first. He's the center. He's the core. And when I say this, understand, there are a lot of our brethren who don't understand this, who put lots of other things first, and oh, by the way, I'm going to go to church. No, you're not. You are the church. We're never get that. You're not going to. You are. And if you're going to someplace, you're taking it with you. And I think Romans 12 says you better be honoring and worshiping God, verses 1 and 2, every day of your life. There's other passages too. So God is first. And then you see the next ring is your spouse. And by the way, the next ring is your children. Those are not inverted. And if you invert them, if you put your spouse after your children, you messed it up. You know, don't do that. Don't do that. Spouse comes second, only to God. And then your children. And then everybody else kind of just, you know, goes into that. And that's mom and daddy. That's sisters and brothers. That's best friends. They all go after all of those things. You know, put God first, your spouse second, your children third. Because again, someday, hopefully, your kids are going to go off and have their own life. And you're going to look at each other and go, who are you? Hopefully you don't do that. Okay, I'm talking about that with a baby thing earlier this morning. Not earlier. Number two, be considerate of your spouse's former situation. Again, we're primarily talking about remarriage. But, you know, there are some people who get married later in life, and so they've been dating, they've been doing other things, and then all of a sudden, they decide to get married, which is great. And they bring in that baggage with them. Now, if you've been remarried, or if you are remarried and you're into a second or third marriage, then the problem with this is you kind of bring in lots of other problems and issues and circumstances. Sometimes it's difficult working with those former situations. And we're going to talk about those just a little bit here in a few seconds. The third thing is, put their happiness above you. I'm trying to turn passage of Scripture and talk at the same time. I want you to look at this passage of Scripture over here in Philippians chapter 2. I really like when we're talking with married couples to use this passage of Scripture a lot. Now, is it for... Did Paul write it for husbands and wives? The answer to that is no, yes. It's no because in the context it's written to brethren. But if my wife is, and she is, my sister in Christ, then shouldn't I at least treat her as well as I treat my other sisters in Christ? I actually think there's a lot more to it, okay? That I ought to treat her much better than. But I ought to treat my sisters in Christ, so I saw one of those things. Philippians chapter 2, New American Standard says, do nothing from selfish conceit. He actually says empty. Selfish for are empty conceit. But with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourself. What if, would your marriage be any different if every single decision you ever made concerning your spouse or your family, you practice this? Nothing selfish. You always put their desires first. Now, understand, we do a lot of things that we don't mean to put our own self there first, but we do. And all of a sudden we're wondering, do I give her half of the candy bar or eat it all and she won't find it? We don't do those kind of things. You know, for us, now I will tell you one of those times when I have to think about it and I think, well, am I being a little selfish here? You know, my wife really likes cigarette bars. So if I go to the store, now in our part of the country we have a store called Sheets all over the place. And if I go into the sheet store and I think, oh, you know, like a cigarette bar. That sounds very good. But then I first think, you know, I want a water bar. Oh, that's right, you like a cigarette bar. Or am I thinking of her first? And then thinking, oh, yeah, well, I wouldn't mind having a candy bar myself. How do we think about it? And you know, that's just a little thing. But then we start doing that in a lot of areas of our marriage, and then it can get into being problems. Here's what Paul says in verse 4. Do not merely look after your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. And again, he's talking about the church. Well, what if I'm looking out for her interests instead of my own? How will that change our marriage? I can tell you the instant, and I don't know when it happened, but the instant that I turned that switch, our marriage began to get better. Because I wasn't worried about me. I wasn't worried about, well, how about my needs, things for me? I was worried about her. And you know what happened? Not by choice, but what happened was, she was like, well, you're certainly. And I don't know whether there was a conscious thought to that, but, you know, it's a reciprocal thing. Phileo is a reciprocal love. You know, I love her, she loves me. I love her, she loves me. And it's a reciprocal thing. Agape is not. Agape is a straight line. God so loved the world. Remember the two lessons we've had so far? God so loved the world. Was that because the world was so good that God sent his son to them? No. No. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son in spite of, not because of, well, how do you treat your husband? Is it because of or in spite of? See, agape says, I'm going to serve my wife. And if we get over to Ephesians chapter 5, you'll find it that Paul says, husbands, love your wives even as Christ loved the church. Whoa, what a standard. By the way, wives, you're to submit to your husband even as you do to the Lord, Jesus Christ. And that same passage that's there. Number 4, don't make comparisons. Oh, by the way, don't look at the numbers and think, well, she's all messed up. I know, I've sat in the audience too. He's 4, he said 7. But he might have another 7. Mike. So, gotta keep you awake somewhere. Don't make comparisons between your two spouses, your ex and your present. Again, I'm talking to primarily the remarried. We counsel and coach couples, and we tell them, look, I don't care how good or how bad. This present husband is not bad. And I'll tell you, and by the way, the illustrations that we use, you will never know who we're talking about, okay? So I just want you to know. But we have a couple who were both married before. And one of his problems was, and this is, we have a lot of us, but one of his problems was very harsh anger. I mean, he would get angry at the drop of a hat and carry two or three hats with him. You know, you're just that kind of guy. Love changing. And he really made the change. And so when he got married and he would want to get angry, he would turn around and walk away instead of exploding. Well, that sounds real good as I'm telling the illustration, but here's the problem. His wife would see him walk away and thinking, you don't love me. You
You're ignoring me.
What's wrong with you? Why are you doing this? Because her former husband used to abuse her. And so she had all these defenses built up. I can tell you that Elaine and I started helping them look through each other's eyes. No, this is not how he's processing it. And this is not how she's processing it. And all of a sudden, they started learning that it isn't that he's upset at you that he's walking away. He's actually more in love with you because his former spouse, he used to stay and argue and fight and shout. And she was like, oh. So you need to not make comparison. That's not easy. That's so hard to not do. Because our natural reaction is to go based on our habits and our past experiences. You know, we go in that direction. However, that's one of the reasons why we encourage people to have someone that can help them as a third party, that can help you. And we encourage, if you're going to get marriage counseling or marriage coaching, that you do it with a husband and wife. It doesn't have to be that way. Obviously, there are lots of good counselors out there that, you know, meet with as one person with people. But it really helps because there are ways that I'm trying to help the wife understand some things, and all of a sudden Elaine speaks up. And the wife goes, oh, okay. And I'm going, now wait a minute. But I've learned over the years, and a lot of times I'll turn to her and say, well, can you help her understand what he's thinking or going to? Because we've gone through some of those things. And so all of a sudden she's relating those things to the other person, and she's helping them not make comparisons to that person. You see, old memories, habits, old patterns from your former marriage leave scars. And you don't always know those scars are there. You don't always know those circumstances. And even if you're married for the first time, every third house in your neighborhood has somebody, every third house in your neighborhood has somebody who's been either remarried or the child of a remarriage. That's a lot of people, folks. And they carry those scars with them into the marriage. And they begin to understand how messed up their life is. And they don't know how to get out of it. And you have the answers. You have the very practical answer for them in your relationship with who God is. This one's sometimes hard, but give your spouse the benefit of the doubt. You know, you don't understand what they're doing or why they're doing it. Your former spouse didn't do it that way or didn't do it that way. You know, whatever the circumstance is, go, okay, I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. When we're working with people, one of the things that we were taught as preachers is when church members start getting upset, don't get upset with them because they may be thinking about somebody else over there instead of you. And so we're kind of taught to not get to that level. Give them the benefit of the doubt. They are right in their feelings. They are right in what they're going through in their mind. Okay? Let's apply 2 Peter chapter 1. Now, I would like for you to go over there. We're going to take a little bit of time. See, he just got 5 points. He's got none. Why not none of this for you? But this list, I always like it when the Holy Spirit writes an outline for me. Always like that. Always a good thing. Look in 2 Peter chapter 1, Jerry. Okay, chapter 2. Verses 2 through 11. Now, I know you're going to look at this passage of Scripture and you're going to say, well, you know, this is about us growing as Christians. It is. But I want you to apply to marriage, whether it's your first marriage or second or third marriage, whatever it is. I want you to apply this to your marriage. It is really and can be the spiritual building blocks for maturity. And if you apply this to your marriage, you'll have peace. That's not because I came up with this outline, by the way. That's because Peter is the one who gave it to us. The Holy Spirit is the one who actually has given us this outline. And so we want to look at this passage of Scripture. First of all, if you look at the passage here, starting in about, we're going to start in verse 2. You'll come up to the section where he gets down to talking about the verse 2. He says, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Seeing that he has that his divine power, excuse me, has been granted to us, pertaining to everything, to life and godliness, through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. For by these, watch this, for by these he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises. What's a promise? A promise is not, well, maybe I'll get around to it. No, this is a promise to God. So that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lust. Do you want to be different in your marriage than your neighbors? Practice this passage of Scripture. We will escape the things that the world is trying to get us to do. And I know this isn't a passage about marriage. It's about our own growth. But if you apply it to your marriage, you'll be amazed at how you'll grow. New American Standard. For this reason, also, applying all diligence. I really like how the NIV, the New International, translates this word, the word diligence, make all diligence, make every diligence. Applying all diligence, excuse me, I'm trying to quote it from the NIV. It says, make every effort. Wow, I like that. Make every effort. What that means is, nothing is going to escape how you try to do it. You know, you're going to make every effort to apply these things to your life. Well, but what if there is no way? Make every effort. Apply all diligence. Okay? Now here's what you're going to do. You're going to, in your faith, supply, New American Standard, supply this next concept here of moral excellence. Well, what is faith first? Faith is a conviction. Faith is a belief. Faith is a trust factor. And what do you have faith in? You have faith in Jesus Christ. You have faith in the Bible. I hope that you have faith in these facts. Because that's really what we're talking about with this particular context. Do I have faith in my spouse? That's where it begins. And then I'm going to build, I'm going to stack on top of that this idea of moral excellence. Moral excellence is a quality of your life that is first rate. That is first rate. I wonder how my lady would like it if I came home and I said, honey, how was your day? She told me about her day. She said, well, how was your day? You know, I think I was faithful to you today. What? Well, I think I was. I mean, truthful. Well, no. That was doubt. And that's not supplying this concept of moral excellence in my life and in our marriage. You know? It is, yes, I was. Absolutely. 100%. As a matter of fact, I might tell her some things that I did to steer away from the negative things. But moral excellence is this idea of my quality of life is first rate. Character is superior. How about my marriage? Is the character of my marriage superior? Now, two concepts about that, and that's male and female. And we react to stimulus differently. Men, ladies, you probably don't have never heard this before. Men are very visual creatures. Guess what? God made us to be stimulated when we see something that is of a sexual nature to us. Man, I'm glad we live in a world that we never see anything that is of a sexual nature. Oh! Men are stimulated. So, ladies, number two, you have a choice. You can pray for him that when he is stimulated, he'll make the right choice. He has that moral excellence. You know, when the not-so-secret commercials come on, do you change the channel? Guys, be careful. Be careful. See, you need to have a marriage of moral excellence. Do you take a second look when somebody crosses your path that is not so modest? Or do you turn away from it? It's moral excellence even in your marriage. And ladies, you have some other ways that you do similar kind of things. How about knowledge? The third one is knowledge. How much do you really know about each other? And I don't mean just, I know who he dated, I know where he was raised, I know his brothers and sisters. I mean, really know the person. Yeah, I talk about having a date night. By the way, Lane and mine's date night is Friday night. And so every Friday night, we have a date night. Do you realize what we were doing? Our last date night? We shared it with you! But we did have 11 hours in the car leading up to that. From Altoona up there. But we'll make that up. We'll make that date time up. But you know, we share some of those things. But we get to know one another. We talk about things. And what's interesting is, over the years as we've worked with couples, we've had an interesting transition because people will say things to us and we'll be working on their problem, and then we'll say, is that a problem there? Is that something that we need to work on? You know, or is there something related to that? And so we've learned a lot of things in doing our marriage seminars. We've learned a lot of things in working with couples. Not because, you know, they're all messed up and they have all problems. Because not everybody that comes to us has a bunch of problems. They just don't learn how to take a marriage from good to great. And we can help them with that. We can help them to do that. How about this one? How about self-control? Are you in control of your life? Are you fully in charge of your mind, your body, and your spirit? And I'm talking to both men and women here. You know, are you really in control of who you are in your marriage? When you say things, are they always positive about your husband or wife? Always, every single time. You know? Are you self-controlled? Do you boost your husband or your wife's self-esteem? No, because if I did that, he'd get a big head. No! I have never met a husband or a wife yet where husband and wife just continually pump them up, and finally the wife says, yeah, you don't have to give me any more compliments. Forget it. No. You don't have to tell me you love me anymore. No! We love to hear compliments, not flattery, compliments from people who care about us. And flattery is you saying something good about somebody else to get something for yourself. You know, this is really good in your life so that I can feel good about me. That's flattery. A compliment is, I'm going to give you a compliment because I want you to feel good about who you are. In God's life, maybe. How about this one? Perseverance is the next phrase, next word that Peter uses. And if you look at this passage of Scripture, he's not talking about, well, this is a cafeteria style. You can have a little bit of this one. No! He says, in your moral excellence, and you keep stacking on top. And I want you to do this for your marriage. Are you going to do everything humanly possible to make your marriage work? You know, I haven't, maybe you have, brother, but I've never had anybody stand at the altar in a wedding, and I've done probably an average of two weddings a year over 43 years of preaching. That's a couple. I've never had anybody stand before me and say, wait a minute, Jared, honey, 7 years, okay, 7 years for me to divorce. No, nobody does that. Everybody stands at the altar saying, we're going to be the exception. And about 47% of everybody that stands there gets a divorce. Put this one in there. Persevere. I'm going to do everything. I'm going to make her. I'm going to make the word godliness means holiness, or I'm going to raise my marriage. Is your marriage holy? Is it acceptable to God? You know, in what we do. And people ask us a lot of times, you know, can I do this in marriage? And I always know there's one of about three things, and I'm not going to mention them publicly. There's one of about three things they're asking permission to do. And I will mention one, which I think is really strange. They say, can we bring somebody else into this marriage? Are you kidding me? No! I just let your mind wander on the other two. I don't know why. But if my marriage is holy, if I'm before God, that question should never even think about being asked. By the way, that's asked by brethren. That's sad. Or these people who call themselves Christians. But if my marriage is holy, nothing gets in between her and I. Nothing. Nothing ever. No, it didn't. If I even see something start to enter, I'm the head of the house. I know she's the neck that turns the head, but I'm the head of the house. You can use that too. Hey, you got it, huh? Brotherly kindness. Are you kind to your husband or your wife? If somebody were to take a poll of the people you work with, the people you spend your free time with, you know, whether that's bowling or I don't know, doing something else, dance class or Zumba or whatever, and they were to take a poll and go around and ask all the people that you associate with in a 6-month period, would those people that you associate with say, you know, she really loves her husband? Or would they say, boy, she really thinks her husband's a stinker. She doesn't like him at all. I don't know why they're married. If people think that about our marriages, you think maybe that's part of the reason why they don't want to come to our churches? Oh, I know. I left preaching and went to bed, didn't I? But you see, that is part of it. And we have marriages where we're tearing each other down, and then we're wondering why we can't reach them with Jesus. We're the same way as the rest of the world when we do that. This idea of brotherly kindness means I'm going to treat my wife in the absolute best possible way I can. I'm always going to speak well of her. We realized at one of our seminars a few years ago, we realized we still do it, that now, 43 years, I can honestly stand in front of you and so can she, we have never one time in 43 years said a disparaging remark about the other one to somebody else. Not one time. And the reason for that is, you know, I saw my mom and dad. I saw all the things that they did. I thought, I don't want to go there. So I'm going to do everything I can to promote her to the world. And we do that. And brotherly kindness is certainly one of those concepts that are there. Oh. And then you wrap it all up with love. Sorry. You wrap it all up with love. And again, this is that idea of agape, sacrificial love. Doing what's in the other person's best interest. That's what agape love is all about. You remember I had seven things? You remember what I left off with? Left off number five. So let me give you number six. Listen to your spouse and children as they need you to listen. By the way, when I was first married, I did this verse, James chapter 1, verse 19. I did this verse, but for some reason, I kept getting it turned around. I was very, very, very quick to speak and slow to listen. And found out that's not the way these verses work, is it? It's interesting how we can turn these verses around in our head. That's not what this verse says. James says, no, this is my beloved brethren, let every person be quick to hear or listen, and I want to add to you, listen how they want you to listen. Remember in the first session I talked about how that we really need to listen, not to fix, unless it's ladies listening to husbands. And for us guys, we need to listen how our wives need us to listen. Slow to speak and slow to anger. spouse and children as they need to listen. And number seven, and I just kind of went through and put them in the list. And, you know, you could probably go back through and change the order of these things. Paul says to the church of Colossae, again, not a marriage passage, but it's certainly one we ought to put their life. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you put off the old self with its practices. What if every marriage in America just did verse 9? Never lie to their spouse or about their spouse. Whoa. You've heard people. Well, he'll never. No. I hate these commercials. And I don't use the word hate very often, but I hate these commercials. Don't tell your mother.
What?
Don't tell your father.
What? But even the kids. You're teaching the kids to lie and hide things.
Whoa, watch what you're talking about. Don't lie to one another. Verse 10. And having put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge after the image of its creator. Does your marriage look like Jesus' marriage? I got a book from, and I apologize, I can't think of this, the author's name. He's out of Georgia, brother out of Georgia. And he wrote a book, and the book is called The Perfect Husband. And I thought, I need that one. I want to get there. I like the book, but when I picked it up and started reading it, I thought, oh yeah, well of course. It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. And interestingly enough, the book is written by, I think, seven different guys, or six different preachers. And they take an aspect of Jesus, and then they compare it to marriage. It's a really good book. It's a really good book. Perfect Husband. If you send me an email, I'll get you the title and where it's from and everything. But it's a great book. And it tells me, I need to imitate Jesus as a husband. Jesus is the perfect husband. And if I can be half the husband that Jesus is for my wife, that's okay. You know, that's okay. And I need to keep doing more and more and more. And by the way, if you're looking for another passage of Scripture to add to this so that you're taking notes, Ephesians 4, verses 25 through 32, that's where Paul tells us about how to control how we talk and to be completely in control of our life and what we're doing. You brought all sorts of baggage into your marriage. I don't know what your baggage look like. And I don't care if you just, have only been married one time. You brought baggage into your marriage. If you're married a second or a third time, which in the next session, I think at 2:30 or whatever that noon, we're going to talk about how we develop a marriage ministry in our congregation and how we reach out to the unchurched. And I want to give you some statistics. And I've already given you a few statistics. I don't want to give you a whole bunch so that your mind's going, oh, I feel like a math major. But I want to give you some things that I want you to look around. I noticed when I said that at every third house, several of you looked at each other and going, oh, my. But think about it. Start doing some little surveys. Ask your friends, is this your first marriage? People aren't offended. Now, I don't mean to talk to strangers at Walmart, but, your friend. And by the way, did you say this is your second or third marriage? And then they say, yeah. I say, oh, okay. How can I help you with that? How can I pray for you with that? Not a negative, not a bad, not a, you've been married. No. And make sure in our churches, we don't come across the people in that way. Because if you're trying to reach people for Jesus, there are lots of women caught in adultery thrown into feet. There are lots of Samaritan women who want to drink the water that you can reach out and touch. There's a lot of people out there. I appreciate you being here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right.